Welcome back for week two of International Politics of Climate Change. Last week, I introduced the mechanics of the subject, but today we're going to ease into the terrain of global climate politics and map out how we'll traverse that terrain through our journey this semester. I'll begin by identifying global politics in 2021 as a key moment of system-level change in the international system. In that context, I'll argue that international relations as a discipline and as a practice hasn't traditionally done well with complex interdependence due to its anthropomorphic assumptions, and why this is an issue when we think about climate change in IR. I'll then explore how climate change problematizes international relations, asking a series of questions that map out how we'll approach this problem in POL3 IPC over the semester. And finally, I'll touch on the relationship between global responses to the COVID-19 pandemic and climate change, highlighting some similarities, differences, and connections. I've come to the view that we stand at the juncture between two different worlds. It's a pivotal junction in global politics, where the contours of economic and political power are shifting, and where many of the previously settled assumptions of the last two centuries are up for renegotiation. Cycles of rise and decline are periodic occurrences in international relations, and environmental fluctuations have often been a factor in these cycles. Today, human-induced climate change is one of the key forces shaping change in the international system and plays a key role in this period of transition at this junction point. What I want to do in this video is try and paint an overarching meta picture of what this juncture looks like. At this junction, we stand with one foot in the old, in a cycle of global politics that's in decline. Now, this cycle has three core elements that are interrelated and are directly relevant to global climate politics. So one is the capitalist world economy. Now, the capitalist world economy is extractive in its operation. It's been largely powered by fossil fuel energy since the Industrial Revolution, and it's based on a systemic logic of perpetual economic growth and an ontological separation from everything non-human. Second, there's a structure of international politics that's based on the institution of the state and the doctrine of state sovereignty. And within that system, there's been cycles of hegemony where one state tends to dominate the world order for a period of time. The third core element has been European colonialism. Now, this was, and to some extent remains, a project of political, economic, military, and cultural domination that's intertwined with the global capitalist economy and the modern state system. Now, we can make a strong case that the world capitalist economic system and the international state system have reached a point of structural crisis, at the same time as the colonial logics of these systems are coming under increasing challenge. Climate change and the broader ecological crisis are both a symptom and an accelerant of these structural declines. Now, if you're looking for some background on this stuff, if you don't have an international relations background, if you're coming from another discipline, please do check out the IR resources I've got in the BEN Study Assistance and Wellbeing portal on LMS. Looking forward from this great historic junction, our other foot stands in an emerging post-carbon world where new economic, political, and social paradigms are evolving right now. They're happening as we speak, though their ultimate shape is still in flux. These are processes that are still in motion. The new thing is still emerging. And one of the emerging trends here is decentralization. So we're seeing decentralizing trends in a lot of different places. We're seeing it in governance. We're seeing it in organizational structures and practices. We're seeing it in infrastructure systems and deployment of info technologies. You know, everywhere where you see decentralization occurring in some form or another, all of this has political implications. And we're seeing this decentralization visible in the increasing rejection of centralized authority. Now, this is happening across the world, and it's coming from all sides of the political spectrum. But let's consider a case study here, which is important to global climate politics, and that's the emerging decentralization of energy systems. So we're seeing an accelerating decarbonisation of the global energy sector, which is largely happening on the basis of market forces through renewable energy technologies. Now, renewables also tend to favour decentralised and distributed production and distribution, rather than the centralised big power station model of fossil fuels. It's hard to understate the importance of this diversification of energy systems away from fossil fuels and the decentralizing trend that lies underneath that. So energy production and distribution is like the heart and the blood vessels of the economy. Energy systems help to shape the structure of economies, as well as the political, social, and cultural relationships that emerge from that structure. So for this reason, energy security is a key element of every country's foreign policy. Energy systems are also closely related to the global financial and monetary systems. So with that in mind, if you change the structure of the global energy system, you're literally redistributing political power relationships at international, national, and local levels. But of course, the broader impact of decentralization goes well beyond energy systems. So as should be clear to anyone who's been watching politics around the world right now, the net result of all of these changing power dynamics of this historic junction or this transition process is a global politics that's increasingly chaotic and unstable. So if you want to put it crudely, the vested interests of the old orders are digging in, while those associated with emerging paradigms are becoming more assertive. And this is what you'd expect to see in the gap when economic systems, political relationships, and institutions cease to be fit for purpose, but before new systems and relationships emerge to replace them. So this is the chaos of that gap. And I see this as a pertinent way to interpret global hegemonic politics, for example. You can use this to understand this century's ideological culture wars across the Western world. Among other things. And it's really a useful lens for interpreting pretty much any issue in IR, which all have some kind of relationship to this transition process. So let's ask why IR as a discipline and as a practice might be poorly equipped to interpret this period of transition, be poorly equipped to evaluate this critical juncture in global politics. And I think it comes back to the core assumptions that IR's built on. So one of these key assumptions, which underpins modern industrial societies more generally as well, is one of anthropocentrism. That's the idea that humans exist as entities separate from and in control of the environment. Now, indeed, our common understanding of the environment as a concept stems from the idea that there's human society on one hand and pristine wilderness on the other, that these are separate things. In this view, the Earth is an object. So if we take an IR perspective of this, the Earth is either the background scenery in front of which the play of social relations and economic production and international politics is performed, or it's the terrain that shapes battle strategies a la geopolitics. Or it's the territory that's there to be conquered or ruled over, or the borders on the map that need to be defended. And you can fit state sovereignty here. Or it's a resource that's there to be extracted and profited from. Either way, in IR, the Earth has traditionally been treated as a thing from which humans are separate from. But from an ecological and complex systems viewpoint, this has never been accurate. Humans have always been just another species within the broader web of life, one of many species existing interdependently within the ecosystems that support us all. In other words, human societies are a constituent part of natural ecosystems, not separate from them. Anthropogenic climate change is a consequence of human societies forgetting that interdependence. So to put that in an IR context, the graphic here presents a rough family tree of the major international relations theories. So where does the Earth fit in this picture? An ecocentric worldview is problematic for IR theories that focus on the state or focus on people as their core frame of reference, without locating those actors within the interdependent relationships with Earth systems in which they're inevitably nested. Do check out the resources for students new to international relations on LMS for background on the major IR theories. It's through the messy politics of the post-carbon transition and the messy politics of climate change mitigation and adaptation that we're starting to see the emergence of models of Earth system governance that aim to re-establish this interdependence with the Earth as a core assumption. But as this is happening, this tension between anthropocentrism and ecocentrism in international relations is something that you'll see popping up consistently as we survey different IR problems from a climate change angle. Can we match the planet with our politics? This is the core question that's being asked in one of our readings this week in Planet Politics, a manifesto for the end of IR. I want to wind up this video by introducing how the core assumption of complex interdependence problematizes international relations across a number of key IR issue areas. This is the story of international politics of climate change, and these are the questions that we'll be exploring this semester. What's the window of opportunity for humanity to mitigate human-induced climate change and to limit its negative impacts? That's what we'll be unpacking next week when we look at the greenhouse effect in the global carbon budget. Are our existing international institutions and existing practices of multilateral diplomacy up to the task of governing a global climate change response? This is a pivotal question. And we'll examine that question in week four when we look at the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Paris Agreement. Is it possible to decouple the global economy from fossil fuels? And is perpetual economic growth the right economic paradigm for the post-carbon world? We'll tackle this loaded question and more when we untangle international climate economics in week five. How should the international community respond to the negative climate change hazards and impacts that are already locked in by the greenhouse gases that are already in the atmosphere? This raises questions about international adaptation and resilience, which we'll cover in week six. Is climate change a security threat? And what are the implications of treating climate change as a security problem? We'll grapple with the securitization of climate change in week seven. Have we reached a point where planetary geoengineering is the only viable option for responding to runaway climate change? The ethical problems and the unprecedented international governance challenges of geoengineering will be covered in week eight. Climate change is a global commons problem, and its impacts are transnational in scale. So is the doctrine of state sovereignty still appropriate in an era of climate change? We'll examine this question in more in week nine. While climate change is a global commons problem, is the responsibility for climate change and the vulnerability to climate change impacts evenly distributed around the world? The global justice implications of climate change are our topic for week 10. What's the relationship between colonialism, injustice, and climate change governance? We'll examine the relationship of the world's First Nations peoples to international climate politics, and we'll evaluate Earth-based international governance models in week 11. What's the role for international civil society in global climate politics? And what are the goals, strategy, and tactics that are more likely to work in pressuring governments and international institutions to taking stronger climate action? The global climate movement is our final topic for the semester in week 12. And it's the most direct link between international climate politics and us as individuals. Earlier on in the video, I've mentioned this relationship between the COVID-19 pandemic and climate change. The COVID pandemic has given us a case study in global crisis response, as well as a signpost to how the international climate politics might evolve in the coming years. The responses of governments and the international community to the pandemic has changed the perceptions of what was believed possible in terms of the scale and the speed of government action in the event of a global crisis. The pandemic has highlighted instances of coordinated international action, as well as instances of predatory and nationalistic behaviour, and it's also raised the nagging question as to why the international community hasn't mobilized with such scale and speed to address the climate crisis. We've also seen the limits of international cooperation on COVID exposed by the prevailing politics of hegemonic competition between the US and China, which is something that's also previously derailed climate change negotiations. The economic slowdown during the pandemic has raised questions about the environmental footprint of economic activity, with calls across the world for the post-COVID economic recovery to feature green development initiatives. The border closures, the lockdowns, and social distancing restrictions have changed how diplomacy is conducted, and it's limited the people-to-people engagements that tend to grease the wheels of international relations. Comparing COVID and climate change, there's also a lot in common when it comes to adaptation and resilience building, including the impact of multiple layers of injustice impacting who is most vulnerable to the virus. There's a lot that we'll learn about in Poultry IPC that's just as applicable to the COVID situation and vice versa, so keep an eye out for any potential connections, because these will be great observations to discuss during our tutorials as well. In our next video, we're going to look at greenhouse gas mitigation and the global carbon budget to get a handle on the scale of climate change and the urgency of the climate threat.